Morning Express it is. It is now just about 16 minutes after 7. Time for us to get into the state of the nation, where we put our hand on the pulse of the nation and find out if we have a healthy heartbeat in certain areas. And joining me to do that, well, I'll start with reintroducing Dismas Mokua, who was already with us during the press review. He's a political analyst. Good to have you staying on board. And karibu tena. We also have Honorable Irungu Kang'ata, who is a member of parliament for Kiharu, and good to have. It's been a while since we had you on set.
Yes, indeed.
Karibu sana. We're also expecting Honorable Moses Kajwang, the senator for Homa Bay, to be joining us as we're going on with the conversation. As soon as he comes in, we shall reintroduce him and continue the conversation. So, gentlemen, karibu sana. State of the nation. And of course, all eyes are on the judiciary right now with the recruiting of a new chief justice and a new deputy chief justice. It was a bit of a harrowing experience that we went through as a country, looking at the judiciary at some point where there was a bit of confusion and we were not sure if the deputy chief justice was going to leave or not, stay until 75. But now that is all gone. We already have a short list of chief justice and the deputy chief justice. But let me start with you, Honorable Irungu Kang'ata, as a lawyer. Maybe tell us as a country, what kind of a CJ are we looking for? What do we need as a CJ?
First and foremost, a person who passes the test of Chapter 6 of the Constitution. That is a person with the leadership and integrity qualifications. Number two, I would imagine we also need a person who is very good in jurisprudence. That is a person who understands the philosophy which underpins our laws. Thirdly, we need a very good Chief Justice who has good administrative skills. You'd imagine his job entails helping judiciary probably to expand more, build more courts, and therefore you need a person who is also possesses good financial and administrative skills. And finally, I would imagine you would need a person who is a team player.
Okay.
Because the bench which you'll be heading, that is the Supreme Court, has is constituted of several persons, not one person. Mm. And therefore, you would need a person who is able to gel well with the colleagues at the Supreme Court.
Okay. This must possibly your view on what we need as a CJ for this country.
Well, I would agree with Irungu, all that he has indicated. But more important, it would be somebody who is actually going to be very strong. And maybe if you compare it with America, we would need a Chief Justice who is so strong that I will not be intimidated by either the president or the two speakers of the of parliament. Mm-hmm. Because the way the Kenyan constitution has been put up, it's got its checks and balances. Mm-hmm. And the three are supposed to respect each other, but again, nobody's supposed to be to get intimidated, say, by the president. And that's the kind of the chief justice we need. And for me, I would also suggest that it would have been appropriate to get somebody who is an outsider, somebody who's not grown up within the judiciary, somebody, an external person, who can keep on with the legacy of Dr. William Mutunga. Because, you know, Mutunga, depending on whom you speak with, Mutunga stands accused of being some sort of a very liberal or an activist judge, but which is really okay. Because the problem we had with the judiciary is because of their status quo. They did not want to embrace new ideas. So you need somebody, again, who can come in and breathe fresh air into the entire system. But most important is somebody who can actually stand on his own and ensure that the judiciary is independent, that all the decisions that are going to be taken respect the constitution and the respect to Wanjiku.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And just to remind you that you're welcome to call and let us know what you think. You're welcome to participate in this conversation, State of the Nation. You are part of the nation, and therefore we welcome you to do that. The phone lines are open, and as soon as you're ready, you can give us a call and we'll take your call. Honorable Irungu Kang'ata, one of the things that Dismas mentions is the fact that you need somebody who's somewhat independent, has not been clouded by the fact that they've been in the judiciary. But one of the things that the former Chief Justice mentioned that he was worried about is cartels that run, you know, even the judiciary itself. Would that be a benefit to us when you have somebody who is not soiled by what's going on and does not have the understanding of the cartels because they're new? Or would you want somebody who is more knowledgeable to a point where he knows that those cartels exist and therefore would probably know how to deal with them?
Well, the idea of cartels, in my own opinion, applies whether you are an insider or an outsider in judiciary. And therefore, I am not so sure as to whether when you bring in a person who is outside, he is able to fight the cartels better, as opposed to a person who is an insider.
Mm-hmm.
In any event, one need to have realized when you appoint a person who has never been a judge or even a practicing lawyer, you run into the risk of having a person who doesn't know to deal with the litigants and also does not understand the philosophy of law. Because you see, it's like you being a news anchor. The more you practice here, the more better you become.
And the more you know the loopholes. And
yes, indeed. Right? So when you bring in a fresher into the system, that fresher will not be able to understand the ropes. You will not understand the technicalities of handling matters. Like, for instance, personally, I've been, for the last about 3 or 4 years, by virtue of being an MP, I've not been practicing. And for the few times I've been in court, I can tell you I felt as if I'm a stranger.
Mm.
And therefore, I can tell you it's very dangerous on our part for us to bring a CJ who is not a judge or a practicing lawyer. He will go to court, he's going to give shallow judgments. And by the way, personally, there are so many matters that I saw and also read where Justice Mutunga handled, and you see the kind of reasoning he was giving out was not really cogent. A good example is the matter that was brought before the Supreme Court regarding whether do we have the one-third gender rule immediately or do we make it staggered.
Mm-hmm.
The Constitution was very clear that it is not something that one has to make it immediate. In fact, when as a judge you proceed to make a pronouncement that you the one-third rule has to be immediate, it means then you are now becoming a legislator, that you are now departing from being a judge, you are not one of those people who make laws, and it's not the work of judiciary to make laws. So I realize what informed him most likely was that notion of the activism in him, and therefore I would not be voting personally for a person who has not been a practicing lawyer or a judge to become the Chief Justice.
Okay.
Notwithstanding the benefits that as a country we can derive from the fact you come from maybe, let's say, the civil society, the academia, but it's very dangerous for a country.
Okay. And just to wing into what you've said, Dismas, there's somebody here who says, this is Mwambu David. He says that the question we had asked earlier on is, what kind of a CJ does Kenya need? And he says, someone who will not leave the judiciary in confusion and should not be an activist. And you've mentioned that word activist. Do you think that is accurate in that we need, first of all, the judiciary was left somewhat in confusion, according to some people. Some might say that it was a wise move by the former CJ to actually quit at that time, so that he gives time for the next Chief Justice to be in office and to be recruited and to have settled in office.
I think David accuses Mutunga, and his accusation has got a merit to some extent, that as the head of the Judicial Service Commission, as the chairman, we needed to engage in very strategic succession planning so that when he leaves, there's no vacancy in the two offices. And I think that's where Mutunga got it wrong. That being the chairman, they should have done a better plan to ensure that by the time he leaves office, there's not going to be a vacuum. That right now we should be having an acting Chief Justice. You notice the presiding judge of the Supreme Court has refused to admit some students to the bar, claiming that he was only given the powers to be the presiding judge, that we don't have a Chief Justice, nor do we have an acting Deputy Chief Justice. So that's a failure on his part. They should have done a very good succession planning. But again, when you look at the other side, and if Gitobi Manyara's reporting is anything to take home, he says there was a lot of manipulation by the so-called cartels to ensure that so many cases went to the High Court, they went to the Supreme Court, and maybe these matters were beyond the control of the Chief Justice. But you see, as a normal Kenyan, as somebody wants to consume law in Kenya, we are not interested to know the shenanigans going on at the Supreme Court or within the judiciary. If you're the head of the judiciary, you're supposed to offer leadership and ensure that there is no vacuum. And when you talk about having the Chief Justice as somebody who has actually been serving with the judiciary or coming from entirely an external part of the world, in my view, there are two ways to look at it. If you get somebody, say a judge of the High Court or the Supreme Court, today to become the Chief Justice, he will understand the working of the judiciary very well, like the back of his hand. But again, there's a risk that he could be part of a cartel. So when he takes office, he's going to perpetuate the values of that cartel. And you know, the name cartel is misused most of the time to mean that it's always evil. It could actually be meaning something good. It could be part of a cartel which wants to ensure that law and order is followed in Kenya. And again, getting an outside person, he will come in with fresh ideas. and is not going to be a dictator in the judiciary. And when Justice Jackson Ojwang was giving his rulings at the Supreme Court, he said the new constitution does not envision somebody to come here to become a dictator and, you know, become like a lord in the old Victorian way. So you're going to be a first among equals. And even if you do not have a very solid understanding of how the judiciary works, my view is your role is to provide policy advice at a policy level, and then you have the registrar and the rest of the persons to implement it. So I think it's really, it's supposed to be a nice mix. But if you put the two in a weighing scale, Kenya is better off having an external going there. He will have maybe trouble during the first 3 months to try to learn what he's supposed to be doing. Then after 3 months, he'll be able to hit the ground running.
Okay. Do you agree that possibly an activist is somebody who do not need some of the decisions possibly made by the CJ, the former CJ, would be influenced by the fact that his history is one of activism?
Well, personally, I would not vote for such kind of a person. And for obvious reasons. One, we know the work of a CJ is quite huge. And the key work of a Chief Justice, in my own opinion, entails presiding a cause that gives certain key judgments in this country. And therefore, if you have no experience in handling matters in court, we do run into a risk of
You could have experience in handling matters in court, but possibly not within our system, such that you're a practicing lawyer and a senior one for that, senior counsel, but at the end of the day, you're not part of the system here, such that now you look at things from maybe an aerial view, as opposed to having being in the system, and maybe part of, you know, you have friends and inclinations towards certain areas.
Whenever you go for an interview, you'll see we do have a certain criteria which a person who is interviewing you is trying to judge you against. And you'll see, I think 90-something% of all people who go before certain panels, they emphasize on the aspect of experience. Mm. You cannot be telling me all those people are being wrong. Mm. There is a very good reason as to why people emphasize on that issue of experience. Mm-hmm. It is not experience on issues which are not related to the job that you're applying for. Mm-hmm. It is always related to the job which you're applying for. Mm-hmm. And therefore, in my own opinion, I think the very reason why all people, all employers always insist on the issue of experience is the same rationale in this issue. I would still emphasize that issue of experience. And experience means you have handled similar matters, you have been able to do an error here, maybe you have done something good here. All that helps you to become a better, it adds up. Mm. And therefore, when you bring a person who was, for instance, maybe a law professor in America, he has never been to Kenya to practice law, he has never been part of a bench, you're opening up our courts to something that is very dangerous. Mm-hmm. A person mm-hmm. is just going there to issue judgments which are very wanting in jurisprudence.
Okay.
And therefore, I disagree completely. Mm-hmm. Or, of course, you never know. He may do something that is good, but that is what we call, it may be something out of the blue. It is an exception.
Okay.
So therefore, we should not be using such to make it a universal norm.
Okay. But the question is then, if we have to take Irungu's position as very accurate and reflective on how the Chief Justice ought to behave, why did the Judicial Service Commission indicate that for you to become a Chief Justice, there's this variety of experience you need? Maybe you should have served in the judiciary, or you needed to be a practicing lawyer, or you needed to be an academic scholar. Then they should have narrowed
it
down.
They were wrong. They were wrong.
The JSC, the Judicial Service Commission.
If I'm told they never provided for that, I can tell you they were wrong. It was an error on their part. Because in my own opinion, you become a better person the more and more you practice that which you think you're supposed to be doing.
What Honorable says makes a lot of sense, but to an extent that requires questioning, that most of the experience that the judges have today is associated with mischief. A number of the judges have been accused of engaging in acts of corruption. And even those who accuse the vetting board of just being merely a conveyor belt, there are a number of these judges, while they could be having 20 years experience, it could actually be the wrong experience that we do not need in Kenya, that we don't need in the judiciary. So really, at the end of the day, I think the Judicial Service Commission, we need to be very careful on who they give us as the Chief Justice.
Which we already have, and maybe let's look at that. And maybe, Honorable Irungu Kang'ata, looking at the list that we currently have, first of all, possibly your comments on some of those big names that many would have thought would be on the final list but are not there. And the reasons given, of course, one would be left wondering why weren't they given a fair chance to be heard, then, you know, go through the due process.
No, first and foremost, this notion that they were not given a fair chance to be heard is erroneous, because first and foremost, everyone knew there will be some shortlisting.
Correct.
So therefore, it goes without saying, once you're not shortlisted, of course you go home.
Is it necessary for us to know why they were not shortlisted? According to LSK, they say that that needs to be made public. We need to know why were they not in, why, what criteria has been used to end up with names that we have.
Well, fine, I'm sure that is possible. I know Judicial Service Commission can provide for that, but in my own opinion, we should not be mourning something that is obvious in all kind of competitions. When you are so many,
it's obvious, but you see, for the sake of integrity and for the sake of being fair, again, given that we are approaching 2017, some may use that against them to say that, how did you come up with this list? How did you come up with the final list of those who are going to be there? There needs to be some level of transparency as to why some have made it and why others have not.
Fine, I have no problem with that information being given out. I think, to the best of my knowledge, Judicial Service Commission has given a public undertaking, it's going to provide such kind of an information. But be that as it may, first and foremost, Law Society does not have the locus standi. It is not acting on behalf of any of those people who lost. If they are indeed acting for those people who lost, they should publicly indicate that. Mm-hmm. Number two, I am very happy with this list. The guys who appear to have lost, in my own opinion, I would be celebrating to have them get out. A person like Professor Makau Mutua, I think this guy is a joker.
Why?
He is a joker of the highest degree.
Why do you say he's a joker?
First and foremost, this guy has never practiced in Kenya. He has never been a judge. And most importantly, when you look at the kind of articles he writes in the newspapers, they are not balanced. Surely, I recall there was a time he made a declaration, does not recognize President Uhuru as a president. And surely, even Raila Odinga himself does recognize Uhuru as a president. Number two, these guys support same-sex relationships. We Kenyans, vast majority of Kenyans, don't support such kind of relationships. So if this guy would have become a CJ, tomorrow we'll be having a judicial pronouncement allowing such kind of
that we cannot conclusively say, because we don't know.
No.
Process.
No.
However,
made a public declaration he supports such kind of unions. And there, by the way, I can tell you, in America, it is usually one of the key considerations, depending on which party is in power. When Democrats are in power, they support people who have such kind of an inclination. Mm-hmm. When the Republicans are in power, it's usually a criteria of whether you're going to become a Supreme Court judge if you hold certain values. So therefore, even in us in Kenya, like myself, a key proponent of the family and religious values, mm-hmm. it serves my interest to ensure Makau Mutua does never become a Supreme Court.
And you see that now is on a personal.
I'm telling you, no. It's not personal. It is ideological. It is ideological, because I belong to the school of thought. If a person who comes from the opposite side of my ideology should not be near any power, whether judicial or political, and therefore, if Makau Mutua would have come to Parliament, I can tell you, we would have knocked him out. The same way, by the way, I've made a public pronouncement. If I see Mr. Lenaola becoming a Supreme Court judge, I will put a protest. He presented the case of CDF, which declared CDF unconstitutional. I was very aggrieved. He presided over this.
One might say you are aggrieved because you are a member of parliament. Let me hear from Dismas in terms of the list.
You know, Honorable Irungu makes very valid statements. Mm-hmm. But again, these statements are supposed to be made in this capacity as a member of parliament, as a legislator, not as a lawyer. One of the most important responsibilities of the U.S. president outside, signing executive orders, is the appointment of the judges of the Supreme Court. And right now, the debate in the U.S. with Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton is that saying anybody who gets sworn into office as the next president will be required to appoint a Supreme Court judge. And the way Irungu has indicated, you are appointed based on your ideologies. Like, for instance, if you are a liberal and the Congress is maybe run by liberals as well as the Senate, then probability of you winning a position is very high. The vetting will be so easy. And you recall when Justice Scalia died, people said we've lost a very strong conservative Catholic, that if issues around abortion land at the Supreme Court, you would actually predict on how he was going to rule. But now, coming back to Makau Mutua, I know there are so many people who would like to dance on top of his grave, but when you look at it with an objective eye,
myself included,
yes, he's penned a lot of articles, and essentially he's been giving his opinions, and he's given opinions over a long time. Actually, people claim that 90% of his CV are cuttings from his opinions, both at The Nation and Standard. So then one wonders, is it prudent for somebody to be punished for giving his opinions? And is the Judicial Service Commission sending a very strong signal that the more you give your opinions, if they're against the system, or depending on how you pen your opinions, then in future you're going to be punished for that? So the Judicial Service Commission, actually, without knowing, is going to be penalizing some legal minds.
That's probably the reason why. That then we need to know the criteria. Mm-hmm. Because we may be assuming that the reason why he does not make it is because his opinions were rather different from what many Kenyans... Oh, let me say different from what many might think. But however, we don't know the exact reason as to why he's not in the shortlist.
Well, under conversation with a number of people who are knowledgeable on this matter, they claim there's a box where you're supposed to tick. Like, for instance, when you're applying for this job, you're supposed to get a clearance certificate from KRA. So if you are applying for a position of a chief justice, and you know you're supposed to produce a certificate from KRA, and you haven't produced it, then in my view, you're supposed to be disqualified on the first instance, even without looking at your reference
just
letters.
Just by basis of the fact that you don't have the basics, minimum.
Yeah, yeah, because you see, when you're going for this position as the chief justice, you're supposed to be very structured, methodological, and you know you have a very good head. A number of them were supposed to have certificates of good conduct released by DCIE, but they were not able to get them. Mm-hmm. But again, on the flip side, and maybe this is something that Honorable Irungu needs to look at, they claim that the Directorate of Criminal Investigations refused to give them the certificates in good time. And GBM Kariuki, Justice GBM Kariuki, has indicated that he wants to go to court. And my view now on the Judicial Service Commission, they've said yesterday that they're going to be giving letters to all the people who are not shortlisted, explaining to them in detail why they were kicked out. But again, the challenge comes with the privacy. If you apply for a public position and you are rejected, is it prudent for the Judicial Service Commission to tell us that these are the people who have been rejected and these are the reasons? Or they should just write a private letter, or rather give a letter to the applicant and tell them, you applied for this position, we regret to inform you that you did not make it. And for me, in the interest of accountability and consistent with Chapter 10 of transparency in the recruitment process, the Judicial Service should have indicated that if you are not shortlisted, we shall give a reason in public on the reasoning. We shall make public the reason as to why we did not shortlist you, mm-hmm. so that we actually know. Because people right now may be thinking that maybe Makau Mutua has been kicked out because of his strong views on gays, or because he said he does not recognize the president. Yes, probably has not sorted out his loans with our education loans board, or it's about KRA, or maybe engaged in a crime at some stage. So it's important for them to lift that lead and give us the accurate information. But still, at the end of the day, whether or not you are an activist judge, and there's nothing wrong being an activist judge, because all those are provided in law, is somebody who is going to make rulings consistent with expectations of the constitution. Because the reason why Kenya seems to be in a lot of trouble is we fear that our next year election is going to be contested. Mm-hmm. So when you go to the Supreme Court, we want to be sure that whoever who sits at that Supreme Court is going to
be balanced.
Now, the reason why people in Jubilee have got the fear of Lord in them is because they know Makau Mutua has indicated in black and white he does not recognize Uhuru Kenyatta. And he says that with a big passion. It's as if they used to have quarrels in the village, or they come from Kisii and share a piece of land, that you know it's almost part of his DNA. Mm. So you know, with such kind of person sitting at the Supreme Court as the Chief Justice, then President Uhuru Kenyatta expects
some of the reasons that the JSC has given so far is to do things like temperament, and maybe those come out when you do an article like the ones Makau Mutua has done. But let's also look at in terms of having an impeccable record, because the Judicial Service Commission right now, in the eyes of Kenyans, does not look very clean. given some of the accusations that have gone through. For instance, we do have the case that was going on that had to be stopped of Judge Tunoi, but because he retired, then of course it stopped. But we also have the likes of David Maraga, who had been accused in 2012 by the LSK of dishonesty, and he fought it off, dishonesty and bribery. In terms of now trying to clean up the perception of Kenyans of the judicial service and the judiciary generally, should we have the likes, anybody that has anything that, you know, would almost taint that reputation, given where we are coming from as Kenyans?
Yes, of course, it goes without saying that we would want a person who doesn't have any baggage. We would want a person who is very clean. I would agree with that insinuation that indeed we'd want a person who has a very good image, even in terms of public opinion, the way the people view him. Mm. And therefore, I would agree with that statement that indeed we should have a CJ who is quite, let me say, clean. Popular and clean amongst Kenyans.
Okay.
You know, if you're Catholic, you know that everybody is born with an original sin which has been cleaned up. And we live in a society called Kenya. And Jesus once said that he was not sinned cast the first stone. All these judges, one would assume they are lawyers. So at some stage, they were engaged in all manner of mischief. I think the responsibility would be whether or not they have accepted that in the past they sinned, or they in acts of omission or commission that they may have done, they've now become like Saul on the way, they've become Paul to Damascus, and they've repented. Because if you look at all those judges, and you look for a microscope, at some stage you'll find there was a mischief. Mm-hmm. Even Bill Clinton was accused of inhaling some drugs. So even in Kenya, the situation is going to obtain. But again, when you hold a public position, it's generally accepted that 50% of the population will not like you. For instance, Honorable Irungu here, if you go back to his constituency, there are 20 people will say that he has squandered CDF resources simply because they don't like him or because they want to run for his parliamentary seat. And the same would happen with the judges. There would be two litigants. One believes that I'm going to win this case. And when he loses, he accuses the judge of having received a CAC envelope. Mm-hmm. And if, for instance, Justice Maraga was able to go out and clear his name, then I don't think anybody should be holding that against him. Mm-hmm. Although, again, we realize some of these judicial officers are very crafty, that when they engage in any mischief, there are no fingerprints left. So they do a clean job. You know, they behave like clever thieves in China. They steal in a very sophisticated manner that there is no fingerprints.
Okay.
But again, there's an important point that we must not lose fact of, that these guys are not going to operate in isolation, especially if you're going to be the Chief Justice. You'll be sitting with your colleagues, and in as much as you want to be a dictator, they'll tell you to put a stop to it. Mm-hmm. But my view is, and maybe Irungu would be able to advise this, if you've applied for a position as a Chief Justice and you are a judge maybe of the High Court, Supreme Court, or the Court of Appeal, and you've been disqualified, then I think it's prudent for you at that stage to actually resign. Because if you cannot serve as a Chief Justice, then what are you doing as a magistrate? Or rather, what are you doing as a judge? Mm.
Mm. But again, of course, in Kenya, resigning remains something that is only done when you know, completely frustrated. Maybe as we wind up, Honorable Kangata, and maybe move on to something else, your comments regarding the fact that it looks like it's almost... we are yet to see, but it's almost set that we'll have a male CJ and a female DCJ, looking at the shortlist.
And first and foremost, I think it's problematic for this country to pigeonhole certain position for certain gender. When you have a situation where it goes without saying the CJ is going to become a male, the deputy CJ is going to become a female, is unfair. I believe whether you are a man or a woman, we are all equal. We are all equal before the law, and therefore a woman cannot become a good CJ notwithstanding her gender. Mm-hmm. The same can also apply for a deputy CJ. Mm-hmm. A man can become a good deputy CJ notwithstanding his gender. Okay. And therefore this notion, it appears like a practice. And by the way, I will not blame Judicial Service Commission. Even when you look at the profile of the applicants, the males tended to apply for the position of Chief Justice. Mm. The females tended to apply for the position of DCJ. Mm. And therefore, strictly speaking, we cannot really blame Judicial Service Commission, because it was not the one which was doing the applications. Mm. It was upon the females to apply for that top position. The same also for the men. Be that as it may, I think when you look at the cast which has been shortlisted, it appears to be a very good cast. I am sure either of them, whether it's a man or a woman, they are going to become good people who are going to serve this country well. And but of course, when it comes to the seat of CJ personally, but this is my very humble position, I would probably be leaning to a person like Zamba Kitonga, because I know his history in terms of his work which he has done in public life, and everyone knows that. And also the fact he has been practicing as a lawyer for so many years. I would imagine he has acquired the necessary skills required for the position of a CJ. Mm-hmm. I will not mention my favorites when it comes to the seat of Deputy CJ. I do not have any favorite for that position.
Okay.
But... allow me also to disagree a little bit with my colleagues regarding the issue concerning ideology. You see, law is not a natural science. It is a social science. And therefore, you cannot really say we have certain set rules which are unchangeable. No wonder you always find in a case there is one lawyer interpreting a law this way
and another one this way.
And therefore, it being a social science, the issue of interest and ideology comes into play. Therefore, in my own opinion, I would, in a purposive manner, pick judges who belong to my ideology, who interpret law the way I would want it to be interpreted. Even in school, we usually have what we call several schools of thought. Like, there are those who are known to be what we call positivists. There are those we call the natural law school lawyers. We also have others we call the sociologists. Mm. So okay. Therefore, if I belong to either of those schools of thought,
likely to tend toward one who would think that.
Yes, so therefore, no wonder I want to justify the dropping of this guy who is called Professor Mutua. I'm very happy.
Because you've made that very clear.
Yes, because the idea is, he belonged to a school of thought, in my own opinion, that if it gets into that position, it will start the process of rewriting laws, which is dangerous, because when it comes to the power to write laws, that is vested on elected representatives of the people, that is either the Senate or the National Assembly. But you find in some jurisdictions, including Kenya, judges who appropriate that role. And they start making noise.
All right. Desmas, maybe as we wind up on this, your comments regarding, do you have any that you'd favorite?
Well, you know, my favorite would be Justice Visram, for several reasons, that he doesn't belong to any ethnic community in Kenya. And you realize that's the new trend that the members of Jubilee are beginning to show Kenya. When there was a big crisis at the Kenya Airports Authority, I think somebody made a call that let's get a white man so that we don't have the people from URP fighting with the TNA. We're supposed to be the chairman, we're supposed to be the MD. So for me, that would be my preferred position. Having somebody who doesn't align himself to any particular community taking up that position.
Although that then would seem unfair, because don't we have Kenyans who can actually do that? Does it have to be a foreigner for us to represent the face of Kenya?
Well, you know, Justice Visram is actually a Kenyan because he was born and brought up in Kenya. In fact, he was born in my village in Kisii, but you know, he's Indian. So that would be, in my view, that would be a good position. Because the Kenyans will become very nervous. When you see a Kikuyu man in a particular position, you imagine that he's going to be dancing to the tune of President Kenyatta. When you see a Kalenjin man somewhere, you think he's going to be dancing to the whims of Deputy President Ruto. So if you have somebody who appears to be very neutral, that would make a lot of sense. Mm. But coming back to what Irungu has indicated, at some stage, the judges actually write laws, although inadvertently. Like when you look at the U.S. in the Supreme Court, they actually, if there is a confusion, they can interpret laws in a manner suggesting that they are rewriting it. And if the legislators consider that it's a wrong thing, then they can come up with another act of parliament to reverse what the judges have written. So that shouldn't worry anybody. But my primary fear, members of the National Assembly, I fear that they're going to be punishing some of these candidates for expressing their views and opinions. And I don't think they should express their, judges should be punished for expressing their views and opinions in laws, provided they're consistent with the Kenyan constitution. Like, for instance, to say that you are going to punish, say, Justice Lenaula for declaring, making a ruling on the CDF, and it was merely following the constitution, I don't think that would be a good idea. Even to punish somebody like, say, Professor Makau Mutua, for expressing his views about, say, that he's a very liberal man. I know Honorable Irungu has led demonstrations in Kenya saying that anybody who's going to support this kind of gay unions is unacceptable. But you know, Macau, Professor Makau has got a different ideology. So I don't think somebody should be punished for holding a different ideology. And he has just indicated here that he's waiting for Justice Lenaula. That if his name goes through, he'll be waiting in the National Assembly to
No, you see, yeah? Choices have consequences. If you are people, yes, they do, of course. That's what I'm saying. Choices have consequences. If the way you look at things, if the people who share your values, they are in power, it goes without saying you are going to ascend up. But there is no way I'm in power and I help you to ascend into power and you don't share my view of things. You wait until I'm defeated. You are people who share your...
But is that the right way to go? Let's take the UK for an example.
It happened. It happens, by the way, those jurisdictions. In fact, there, they don't even lie. They say, you are a conservative. Yes, this position, we leave it for a conservative. You are a liberal.
But look at Theresa May, as the one in charge of foreign affairs, given that he was pushing for Britain to leave.
And why did Cameron leave? Because he said very clearly, I cannot be able to negotiate UK to leave European Union, whereas I don't support that idea of us leaving. Mm-hmm. In fact, even me, in my own opinion, she's doing that thing which is very wrong. She is now starting to help the country to get out of IRS. She was of contrary opinion. Mm-hmm. But in fact, in all developed societies, people don't have this notion of you are neutral, you're independent. That notion of neutrality indeed is usually a cover or a decoy for a person who is taking
a
position. There's nobody who is neutral in this world. So they usually declare their interest very early and disclose it. And so that when you are making a choice, it's very clear, I'm mapping you to ascend a certain position because you hold this position.
Okay.
So therefore, here in Kenya as well, we should adopt the same methodology. Renaola does not believe in CDF, so he should ensure wherever he comes before as a parliamentarian, we punish him. I'll give you a good example. There's a certain friend of mine wanted to become a commissioner of Kenya National Human Rights Commission. I'm not going to mention his name. And he came to Parliament. He is a very good friend of mine at a personal level. But he does not support CDF. He also supports same-sex relationships. So he lobbied me. I told him, fine, you are my very good friend, but I can't support you. Because if I support you fine as a friend, you'll become a commissioner. But you are going to champion values which I strongly disagree with. So the same rationale should apply in Kenya. Mm-hmm. Don't lie, don't hide. If you decide to become a liberal, fine. Ensure the day liberals, we are going to capture state power.
Then accept that. Dismiss your conclusion.
Well, for me, I think is... It's unfortunate that that's how democracy works, because the people of Kiara have given him the opportunity to represent them in the National Assembly.
And he's representing their values.
Obviously, majority of Kenyans would actually punish any liberal thinking that supports gay unions. If you go to the streets right now at, next to Kencom House and you ask how many guys support gay sex, you'll probably get a beating, you'll be beaten into a pulp and probably taken to the police station. Mm-hmm. But the point I was trying to make is that the Judicial Service Commission and the National Assembly should encourage liberal thinking. Even if it's a conservative thinking, you should encourage conservative thinking. Because can you imagine, for instance, if majority of the members of the National Assembly happen to be liberals, and you have people are being nominated to these positions who are conservatives, the conservative guys are going to suffer because
good,
of
that. Fine. They go home. They go home. They wait until the conservative assume power. Mm-hmm. It goes without saying, but by the way, if you find, let's say for instance, parliamentarians are liberals and they are allowing conservative to assume power, it appears either those people don't know, they don't know what they are really interested in, or probably they are not conscious of the ideological outlook.
Okay.
But Mike, I really think at the end of the day, the Judicial Service Commission should actually take a decision and tell us in public why these names are not accepted, so that we stop engaging in the realm of propaganda. Probably people are saying that Professor Makau Mutua was very close to Dr. William Mutunga. That's the reason why he's been rejected. And there is that claim by Justice GDM Karioki that the DCI has been a very active part in this recruitment process, that it delayed giving people those certificates of good conduct, or even maybe KRA delayed in giving people those clearance certificates. So it would be important to declare that information in public. In any event, that's what the Article 10 of the Constitution talks about, as transparency. And the moment you open yourself to a public position, then be sure that Wanjiku will be interested to know what happens
to know
in the
why bedroom. Why you are either qualified or disqualified. And I think we'll have to wind it up right there, gentlemen, because of time. And thank you very much, Dismas Mukua, who is a political analyst, and Honorable Irungu Kang'ata, the Member of Parliament for Kiharu. And just to read some of your comments that are coming through, Stephen Wambua said shortlisting Professor Makau Mutua could have been the greatest joke done in Kenya. Nzamba Kitonga deserves the position. So it looks like you have people who support your notion. There's Charles Joseph who says, I fully support Honorable Irungu Kang'ata on Professor Mutua's predicament. Very arrogant and abusive. Again, going to perception. There is a gentleman here who says, we need a new CJ with Chunga's administrative skill, Madan's wisdom, Cockerel's piety, and Mutunga's integrity. All right, please, please tell the guests that in common law, the judiciary is a source of law. All right, we'll have to wind it up right there. Thank you again, and thank you for participating. But do stay with us right here on Morning Express. We've got some news updates coming up. Then later on, we'll delve into Tech Central.